I'm delighted to have been invited to speak at this conference, and I'm delighted to be here today. I've been researching charities for 30 years or so, and during the larger part of that time, it's been a fairly quiet subject. Everyone sits in academe, in one's ivory tower, researching, studying, writing. And here I am, 30 years later, and I realize when I'm speaking at this conference that I'm going to say something rather startling. And it certainly isn't my intention to start a revolution, but nevertheless, I realize that the perception of the way the Charities Act 2006 is going to operate does not, in my view, accord with the law. So, for the purposes of my talk, I'm going to explain the view that I have as a lawyer, because I believe, as a lawyer, that ultimately we live by the rule of law. And it's for the executive to apply the law as it has been laid down by Parliament and by the courts. Now, if we're looking at independent schools under the pre-2006 Act law, then under the analysis that I put forward, we see that they have charitable purposes. They are for the advancement of education. And those which are charities, of course, satisfy public benefit in both senses. First of all, because the advancement of education is itself for the public benefit, and also because they benefit a sufficient section of the community. Now, if you charge fees, of course you are reducing the section of the community which is perhaps incapable of benefiting. But the law has established that the requirement is that the number to benefit must be more than negligible. So quite clearly the number who are capable of benefiting is still more than negligible. The contractual nexus I spoke of is inapplicable because the contract, the payment of the fees, is merely the means by which the benefit is conferred. So therefore it's inapplicable in this situation. And the independent fee-paying schools don't fall foul of the statement in Jones and Williams for several reasons. First of all, I believe that that statement does not apply to the advancement of education. If it did, I think that there would have been decisions long ago which had established that. Secondly, the courts, sometimes I say, have talked about excluding the poor. But I think this should be interpreted correctly to mean that a trust cannot be charitable if, in terms, it excludes the poor. Not merely that the effect might be to exclude the poor. So, Henry Risch, Lord Wilberforce, for example, had said to limit admission to a nursing home to the rich would not be charitable. So, if the nursing home were, under the terms of its purpose, expressly limited to the rich, clearly it would lack that requirement of public benefit. But elsewhere in his speech in Reach, giving the advice of the Privy Council, he said that he wasn't saying that the medical facilities were not charitable merely by reason of the expense. The expense meant that the cost of them meant that they could only be enjoyed by persons of some means. Of course, one can also, according to Reich, take indirect benefits into account. Now, of course, the Commission have said that indirect benefit alone, in the context of the advancement of education, isn't sufficient, and they refer to what Lord Wilberforce said in Reich, namely that indirect as well as direct benefit enter into account. And they interpret that as meaning that indirect benefit is sufficient only if there is direct benefit as well. However, the notion that indirect benefit is acceptable in some other heads of charity, but not in the advancement of education, seems to depend upon a notion in the cases that the advancement of education can't be charitable if those to benefit are linked by reference to a personal nexus. So we know that a trust to educate the children of a named person won't be charitable. In one case, Reed Compton, where it was argued that those persons who were educated, the children who were educated, would become good citizens. They were helpful to society by becoming doctors, engineers, and, dare I say, lawyers. That argument was rejected. It was too vague and insufficient compared with the personal nexus, the direct benefit to those people. But that was the crucial thing there, was that they were defined in the trust as being having to be related. So they're defined by, there was a blood relationship. And that's really what distinguishes that case.